Finnegan, kind of physio work at Connect Health. I have a couple of different hats. Also work in like private practice and primarily with the Great Britain basketball team as well. So kind of this is, I presume, where Dale asked me to do a bit about patellar instability, which is kind of ironic because most people with patellar instability don't get to the stage of playing for Great Britain basketball, in essence. So kind of they're kind of normally weaned out kind of earlier on in the stages in terms of kind of getting up to that high level. So first kind of speaker did quite well kind of talk, breaking down what instability is from that kind of his side. From a physio standpoint, obviously I always think of instability as kind of working on the strength, dynamic stabilizers, static stabilizers, and then primarily the neuromuscular control. So kind of we'll talk a little bit about it. So from the background point of view, again, quite low numbers from the research we've been doing, 5.8 per 100,000, and then 29 per 100,000 in 10 to 17 year olds. So when the 10 to 17 year olds come in, kind of obviously you want to kind of be looking at how they developed as children as well. So kind of the early kind of walk in, did they actually have kind of crawling period where they developed hip stability, developed kind of some more kind of lower limb control, or did they literally just jump straight up and start walking as young youngsters from a neurodevelopmental standpoint? And if they did, then they're more likely to go on to develop some type of knee stability issues, particularly in the patella. So again, the recurrence kind of rate in kind of 15-44% in non-operative patients in treatment. So kind of thinking there is quite a high rate, and we just want to think, where do we stand with that? This 10 to 17 year olds as well, tends to be a lot about looking at kind of the hip. So I always think the patella is a pulley, and you're just looking at how that pulley works in relation to the other musculature around it. So that's obviously going to be looking at the knee, or the knee itself, how the actual ankle is moving, and then also from the hip standpoint. Clinical examination wise, relatively straightforward, looking at that medial musculature wasting. And then also looking from a glute control, so that kind of glute stability, can they actually keep their knee over their big toe, and is there a kind of Trendelenburg, and kind of seen from that point of view. One of the main things from an epidemiology standpoint is to kind of looking at the patella alta, so kind of if their patella is sitting quite high and have that kind of banana shape kind of posture when they're standing, that has quite a high kind of prevalence with people who are going to go on to develop some type of instability. If they're doing any jump landing stuff, because they're going from that extreme kind of hyperextended position into kind of almost like a unsafe, unprotected knee flexion position. So kind of from a muscle length testing point of view, tend to look at a bit more overs, checking your ITV, popliteal angle from a hamstrings, and then kind of your Ellie's test, which is basic quad test. So that's kind of one of the main indicators that have some like quad tightness. Particularly if it fits in with the patella alta side of things. With that being said, kind of a lot of times physios are quite culprits of kind of underloading patients as well. So from a point of view of rehab, they do tend not to kind of overload them to the point of working on muscle stiffness, plyometrics, and all these things, which and the eccentric loading, which is pretty important with this population. So contributing factors, kind of a little bit of looking at the kind of MPFL, so kind of medial patellofemoral ligament. So that's the main kind of restriction from a ligamentous standpoint of that passive laxity. So if it is a case that is kind of lax, and you can see that kind of when they cross their leg and their kind of medial condyle tibia kind of just pops up, so there is that little bit of laxity. So it's just being aware from that point of view, lower limb alignment. So kind of what we say is that kind of if you have restricted dorsiflexion, then generally what's going to happen is they're going to have restricted kind of knee flexion as well. So it's kind of a coupled movement pattern. So you kind of want to look at from the lower limb alignment point of view, if they're restricted in their ankle. So for example, with your basketballers, 90% of them wear either ankle braces or have to have their ankle strapped up. So that means it restricts their dorsiflexion a little bit. But if you just do a little bit too much, means that they have to compensate and get that flexion from further up the kinetic chain. So again, from the lower limb alignment point of view, as I said about the Trendelenburg, I'm thinking about kind of movement patterns that they kind of may have to use. So your basic walking, if it is the case that they're getting pain when they're walking, think about sagittal plane stuff, so can they flex and extend their hip? And then kind of, if they can't, does that have a follow-on effect on lower limb down the chain? Osseous formation and the structure of patella and the trochlea. So is there just actually a kind of shallow patella, and is that kind of influencing the kind of more likelihood of kind of any hip problems? So any hip dysplasia issues as well, which might fall that in, so any kind of congenital hip dysplasia. Osseous formation, obviously kind of looking at how that kind of bone developed. So kind of was there any trauma earlier on in their youth as well, so that meant that it may have kind of developed differently. And then the soft tissue, the static control, which is, this is kind of the physio bread and butter. So if it is a case that kind of working on static control, dynamic control, and the neuromuscular control, they don't get better, that's obviously when we kind of say, right, anatomically wise, we need to kind of push this on for your expert opinion. The static control, kind of looking at them static postures. So again, how is that person standing? Do they stand with their knees hyperextended, driving the patella up, quads get tight, hamstrings get long, so they'd never actually have that co-contraction between the quadriceps and hamstrings, to provide that extra element of stability in around the knee. The dynamic control, again, this is where you're looking at kind of any jump landing mechanics. So when they kind of land from a jump, do they actually land with a kind of rigid knee? And so they don't actually get that kind of knee flexion moment. And if they do, then that's obviously going to, again, drive home that kind of patella alta. Because when they land, they're just going to land with a rigid foot, rigid knee, and then that kind of patella doesn't have that stability to control it as it eccentrically loads. So from a hip, knee, and foot biomechanics standpoint, again, the kind of the demonization of pronation of the foot over the last kind of 10 years, pronation of foot is a normal thing. If you can imagine, if you have a foot and everyone said it's flat and you stick insoles in it, drives the kind of foot over in that supinated position, which then means from a follow-on kinetic chain standpoint, obviously it's a case of that's going to drive the patella more laterally and then kind of potentially promote more instability if they do land and do have to do a cutting or change direction movement, because their foot and their patella, is it foot's in a supinated position, the patella will always be in a dominantly more kind of laterally tracking. So that's kind of from a foot standpoint of postures. So you want to actually train pronation sometimes with some patients. They do come in and they do have massive high rigid feet. They don't have, they have less force absorption, so it's a case you need to train that as well from a physio standpoint. Hip and knee kind of mechanics, obviously, touched on, and then also kind of looking at the non-modifiable risk factors for us. So, obviously, kind of with females, kind of it's a very uncomfortable discussion to have that with a guy as a physio, but that's the kind of discussions that we have generally at the start of any kind of camp or period away. Talking about kind of menstrual cycles and kind of in terms of, is that going to impact when we get into the kind of nitty-gritty of the championship time when we're Europeans or so forth. Hormonal influences and environmental factors. So the environmental factors, obviously you're thinking what kind of surface that the patient may or the person may play on. So is that more grass-based? Is it kind of more actually cork-based? And is there that kind of in terms of blades, studs, and all the other environmental factors that may play a role. This was an interesting one. This was a friend sent me this on last week, saying who needs physios. It was a rugby player in Australia who went into a challenge, dislocated his patella, and this is why I love rugby players, because he lay down on the ground and just did this six times, and then kind of relocated it, straightened his knee, went to walk off the pitch, and then he was on the sideline and said, "Ah, no, fine, I'll go back up." So again, that's just kind of understanding from the contributing factors of what kind of the resilience of some people when they have these dislocations or instabilities, that he can go back and play full contact rugby, which is, yeah, debatable on lots of levels how the physio level back on. I guess it's a case of trying to stop a 16 or 20 stone rugby player. Rehab take homes, so kind of again looking at kind of gluteal VMO based strengthening as a initial stages, but then kind of I think we're all guilty of then neglecting the kind of later on stages of the rehab with patellar instabilities. In my opinion, instabilities kind of all stem from kind of muscle stiffness and the inability to kind of recruit recruit that muscle stiffness and then apply that at kind of higher loads,
mm-hmm.
being kind of more plyometric stuff. No significant difference between surgical versus conservative management. That was quite interesting, so kind of did a little bit of digging in that. And then there was no gold standard for patellar instability, so as Nick alluded to, it's a case of sometimes you get more questions than answers and you start kind of looking into these things. That was from over 100 surgical approaches. There was no kind of gold standard to kind of look at saying this is where we need to go with it. So again, from the physio side of things, if someone's unstable or have an instability, sometimes I don't tell the patient that term because it adds an element of doubt and fear and kind of anxiety into the patient's mind, and just focus on the fact that things that we can change, if they don't get better, then that's when we can refer onwards. Again, closed chain exercise, that was a whole debate in physio a while ago, kind of closed chain versus open chain. So closed chain, foot's in contact with the ground, the nervous system has a point of reference, which is the ground, and that's what we base all our movement on. But then when you take away the ground, what happens? So I always think about patellar tendinopathy, the chap that I had in. He was great, could I go out, run 5Ks, or no, sorry, he was running 10 miles, no problems, no pain whatsoever. But I put a step in front of him and asked him to jump up on the step, which is an open chain exercise, and he literally couldn't do it. He freaked the hell out, yet he could run 10 miles with no pain or problems. So that's kind of more the fact that you're just adding in that variability and checking his open chain control and confidence really. So it's more of a psychology side of things behind the open chain control. So that's a Stein-Dotter paper, and then kind of knee taping. Just talk to Nick or Gron about it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's just a case of trial and error with the kind of patella and seeing and thinking about the patterns involved. So is the pattern more of a adductor weakness, abductor weakness, quad tightness, or is there actually a hamstring, which tends to be the case in a lot of these patellar issues, that it's more to do with the hamstring kind of being the root cause and not being strong enough or reactive enough. So that's pretty much it.